We are present in a case, a male 46-year-old software analyst with desk job company. The first is a neck pain with right upper extremity radiculopathy for 4 months. It is a medical history of diabetes type 2, and he is a smoker, and he has already taken treatment with NSAIDs, oral steroids with transient relief. These are the radiographs of the patient, interpostal lateral flexion and extension, and this is the MRI of the patient, T2 and T1 sagittal and axial images.
This is a central cut, this is not a central cut, this is a central cut.
Yes. Mainly we are just giving the example. We will start first the presentation about the cervical disc, that later on. Just an example. We can remove it from the main presentation.
The lateral view, whenever you see, I think they should be on the international, as per international guidelines, they should be on the, other side.
On the other
way. So okay. That also you can.
And in the previous slide as the MRI,
yes,
we can have the
MRI. This
in one MRI is on.
Yeah, the representative cuts actually. This is the central cut.
Yes.
Either you show all the three, the right, left, and the central cuts, and then you show the cross section, because this is not the representative cut.
Again, the first MRI image we are seeing from the one side, and the other right image on the we are seeing from the opposite side. So they should be uniform throughout and from the left side.
Okay. So the conservative treatment is in the form of rest and activity modification, the physical therapy, exercise and traction, cervical brace for comfort, NSAIDs, oral steroids, muscle extension and gabapentin or pregabalin, and cervical epidural steroid injection.
Most of the time when we advise the cervical collar,
yes,
we usually advise it into the extension. That is what increases the pain and patients are not comfortable.
So
we have changed that into the reverse cervical collar.
Mm-hmm.
Meaning patients are told that you wear the collar with the velcro front.
Yeah.
So that really
reverse
gives good relief, I tell you. And they become your forget, I tell you. They will follow whatever you say afterwards. Because then the pain immediately relieves.
Yes.
Because then for a minute you have opened it.
Okay. Sir.
And another thing which is commonly advised by most of us is that, you know, use not to use the
back.
Use a pillow. We advise them to use two pillows or maybe more pillows, you know.
To keep it in flexion.
Yeah, so keep it in flexion, because then knives are usually bad, particularly with these patients.
Oh.
So if you advise them, so these two small little tips, you know, they will make life much more comfortable.
But sir, is there any validated data for the use of cervical brace in cervical radiculopathy, sir? Maybe what you are saying is more apt for a myelopathy case, wherein the flexion is more helpful.
I think the same thing will hold true for the radiculopathy as well.
Okay.
Then it opens up the foramen.
Right. I agree with that.
Yeah.
Okay.
And we have been, you know, practicing this since maybe. But you are right. I think we should validate this. I think that is, you know, comes into our mind.
Yeah. So maybe some papers would definitely make a.
That becomes the best thing.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because usually we talk about these things in flexion for myelopathy, not for radiculopathy.
Well, we do it for radiculopathy.
Yeah.
We have been practicing for radiculopathy. But you are right, for myelopathy as well, radiculopathy.
Yeah. Okay. Then going to the surgical indication, if there is a failed conservative treatment, then we can go for the anterior cervical discectomy and fusion with or without iliac bone grafting. So now we'll be going through cervical radiculopathy as a whole, a review. The aging cervical spine killing.
Before we go any further,
yes,
can we just come back to it? Since it's a module where we are teaching people, we cannot just have one treatment, you know, as labeled as ACDF. So there are multiple people who would probably do a
posterior approach with, if it's a soft disc, and they do a discectomy.
Right.
Or some people would do only discectomy with a graft. So I think we need to highlight everything, not just one treatment as ACDF,
yes,
as one.
Mm. That gives a very wrong message.
Actually, sir, this is basically we have put a single example on the ad. We have gone through the main presentation, we have added everything in there. So this is cervical radiculopathy. The aging cervical spine killing syndromes are in the form of axial neck pain, cervical radiculopathy, acute soft herniated nucleus, spondylotic radiculopathy and spondylotic myelopathy, and spondylotic myeloradiculopathy. Cervical radiculopathy symptoms usually are found in a specific dermatomal or nerve root distribution. Classically, the level specific dermatomal pain and sensory motor reflex agents are there. And pain and paresthesia, usually they represent the earliest symptoms of neural compression. Motor weakness, if present, is usually present late and when compression is very severe. Where cervical spine degenerative disc risk factors, strong association has been found with smoking cigarettes, frequent loading, high risk occupations, load bearer, miner, dentist, driver, prior lumbar surgery, metabolic factors, dialysis, congenital cervical stenosis. And possible factors can be their vibrational exposure, prior cervical trauma, gender, familial predisposition and race. And cervical radiculopathy pathogenesis, radicular pain usually results from compression of nerve root, level of cord, disc, foramen or adjacent foramen can depend upon the presentation. Mechanical effects block exoplasmic flow, alteration in the vascular supplies additive, mechanical deformation with inflammation is likely necessary for clinical symptoms, chronic edema and fibrosis can increase the sensitivity of nerve root to pain. Radiculopathy, common etiologies, it can be in the disc herniations in intraforaminal region, most commonly in younger patients. Sensory changes are more predominant. Posterolateral rhomboid shape of PLL forces herniation to one side, motor changes are more predominant. Central through PLL later stage of degeneration, oncovertebral joint spurs act as a barrier to other types of herniation. It's also more of motor changes are predominant. So radiculopathy, common etiologies, it can be osteophytes, that's hard discs, most common cause of radiculopathy in patients over 55. Oncovertebral or posterolateral spurs, these are usually clinically quiescent. And the differential diagnosis can be in the form of spinal versus extraspinal radicular versus non-mechanical pain, neurologic cerebrovascular accidents, multiple sclerosis, amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, nerve entrapment syndromes in the form of median nerve, pronator, carpal tunnel syndrome, ulnar nerve, cubital and Guillain's canal syndrome, radial nerve in the form of radial tunnel syndrome, thoracic outlet syndrome, shoulder pathology, cardiac or GI pathology, reflex sympathetic dystrophy, brachial neurites or herpes zoster can be all differential diagnosis.
Indeed, I think we should add the amyotrophic neuralgia. That is something which will certainly against the surgical treatment if you are diagnosed that.
Yes, sir. Amyotrophic neuralgia.
And another thing is herpes you have already included.
Yes, sir.
Because then you cannot operate on day one.
Yes, sir.
I think that AMLS is already mentioned.
Yeah.
Amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, we have mentioned.
No, I am not talking lateral sclerosis, amyotrophic neuralgia.
Achha, ectopic neuralgia. Then cervical disc assessment can be in the form of history, examination, laboratory studies and imaging. Presentation usually is sharp pain, burning or tingling sensation in the upper extremity, excellent skeletal neck pain, compression worsens pain while distraction, shoulder abduction, tilting of the head to contralateral size may relieve the pain, sensory loss, motor loss and decreased reflex activity. Radiculopathy specific examination, hyperextension test, head held in hyperextension for 20 to 35 seconds increases pain. Valsalva minor may increase also the symptoms. Shoulder abduction relief test, decrease stress on the root, decrease pain. Sperling's test, rotation lateral bending of the head to the affected side. And axial compression test increases symptoms.
Should we be putting that axial compression because that is not something which you should be advocating?
Yes, sir.
So, one can really put into the bracket, you know.
Yeah, I agree with Dr. Dhawe that I think that should be highlighted there.
Yeah, we should put it in the bracket.
Yes.
Because that's very painful actually.
Yeah,
yes.
Right.
Yes.
Another thing in the basic pathogenesis,
yes.
You see the lumbar disc and cervical disc, they are different things.
Different.
You see lumbar disc ends from one end to other end. Cervical disc is not complete structure from end to end.
Yes.
When you look at the axial cut. So because the end plates they touch each other, but then the it is deficient at the end.
At the end. Sir.
So that is something, that is why it is more painful when you have disc which is into the foramen.
Foramen.
Compared to
the lumbar disc.
Compared to lumbar. The another thing is the story, you know, like we have the three stories in the lumbar disc.
Yes.
Which is not the same here as well. The lumbar root exit different.
Different level.
Yeah,
by the
so
cervical.
That can be just put, you know, as a sort of thing that because somebody is going to take this from the message we are going to go through from this module. So lumbar disc exit is different at different level.
Yes, sir.
That's a very well point.
Yes, sir.
Point taken, sir.
Differentiation.
So there are no stories as you know.
Yes.
Lumbar spine. Mm. Lumbar spine we are.
End to end disc is not there. So
yes.
Foramen they are more painful because there is no, you know.
Cushion kind of way.
Even the exit of the root is very horizontal in
cervical as compared to the lumbar which goes down and traverses. Then the involvement of particular foramina. In C3, C4 neuroforamina, C4 nerve root is usually involved. There is weakness of scapular and diaphragmatic muscles. Sensory loss in the form of lateral neck and shoulder. And reflex is usually very less, scapular reflex sometimes may be affected. Then C4-5 neuroforamina, C5 nerve root is usually involved. There will be weakness of delta and biceps. Sensory loss on lateral arm, regiment sign, and reflex in the form of pectoral and biceps reflex are affected.
Since we are going to include suprascapular, now entrapment could be in the
Yes.
Have we put it?
No, why not put this?
We may do this. Now, if we are going to include the auto survival, which we should include.
Yes, sir. Absolutely. Then going to C6 nerve roots, C5, C6 neuroforamina involvement. There will be weakness of wrist extensors, biceps, forearm supination, and sensory loss on radial and forearm and thumb. Radial forearm and thumb and reflex in the form of bicep and brachioradialis. Yes.
Well, there
will
be restrictions for each group.
Grammatic
representation.
I think it would be better to have
a flowchart instead of a flowchart. And reflex will be affected is triceps. C7 and C8 neuroforamina, there usually C8 nerve root is involved. Actually, then weakness of finger flexors and introche. And there will be sensory loss on ulnar aspect of the hand, including little and ring finger. And reflexes usually are non-reflexes can be usually checked. Flexor pollicis and digitorum profundus are affected along with short, thinner muscles compared to ulnar nerve or AI entrapment. If there is the these forearm syndromes.
It's better not to use those short forms.
Yeah.
AIN.
Yes, sir.
Anterior
torsion
nerve.
Yes, sir.
So you should.
Then say T1 neuroforamina. If it is involved, there is T1 usually involved. There is weakness of introche, sensory loss on ulnar forearm, and reflexes usually cannot be checked in this. Then aging spine. Earliest lesions occur at the disc level. Dehydration secondary to fragmentation is the pathology. There is loss of negatively charged glycosamine glycans. There is increase in collagen. There is disproportional loss of chondroitin sulfate compared to keratin sulfate. Secondary to loss of loading by inept nucleus. Fissures in the annulus can be painful. And disc bulger herniation or nucleus pulposus can occur. These are the aging related changes and along with pathology, pathophysiology. Then loss of disc height. Usually brings the uncovertible joints into proximity.
If you are going to put the aging there,
yes, sir.
I think we should put down the uncovertible joint. Because still the debate goes on whether it is fibrous joint or the
synovial joint.
So I think, you know, at least, and then it is very well known that, you know, these are the soft disc and the hard disc.
Yeah.
The hard disc will be the uncovertible joint which is contributing.
Mm-hmm.
The soft disc will be the soft
disc. Soft disc only.
So the hard disc does not resolve. So that the best way will be either CT scan or oblique x-rays.
Yes.
So that can be included as well. Suppose somebody who comes to 50-55 who has got the hard disk, and you might as well operate early than to wait. Because that's not going to resolve. They are in a lot of pain.
Pain. Right.
So,
absolutely.
So something that can be put with a 45-degree oblique x-rays can be incorporated as well.
Special x-rays and
yes,
or CT scan.
And for that, you know, for that matter, you will be able to judge precisely or CT.
Okay.
One thing I also want to highlight, the points number 3, 4, 5. Do we need to have all these for a, you know, for a teaching purpose?
Well, we can take it out.
Because this is not clinical, this is more
yeah.
of micro level stuff.
Yeah.
So, negative charge, glycosamine glands, I don't think it's going to change anything.
That's
it's
right.
more of,
okay.
you know, research work.
Yeah, in that case, you can add these for uncovertible joint.
Yes.
Okay.
So, that makes more relevant. So, for uncovertible joint,
we
so
should have hard disk and soft disk.
Yeah, so you have
okay.
to differentiate between hard disk and soft disk.
Okay.
And in a aged spine, as Dr. Dave is saying, it's better to operate if it is the hard disk rather than soft disk because it's not going to resolve.
It is always
resolve.
Absolutely. So then loss of disc height usually leads to, it brings uncovertible joints into proximity, disrupts normal facet biomechanics, facet and uncovertible joint eburnation, osteophyte formation and ligament of phloem hypertrophy is usually found there. Then radiological evaluation, imaging in the form of plain radiographs, then MRI, CT, CT myelographs in some patients and electrodiagnostic studies are usually done. Then radiographs in the form of AP lateral and oblique. Lateral usually sees a. Yes.
I think in the DD we missed a double cross syndrome.
Yes, absolutely.
Because I think that's where, you know, we will have the CTS.
And along with
and
cervical disc.
Yep. So I think that is something which we should be putting there as double
cross syndrome. And also then in the form of upper vein thrombosis.
Absolutely,
that.
Yeah.
That
I think it may be, you know, rare, but I think might as well include.
Yes. Then this x-ray is in form of AP lateral and oblique. Lateral x-rays which reveal disc height, facet status, osteophyte formation and alignment. Enterostophytes usually larger than poster but still clinically significant. Then degenerative change seen in 25-50% of the population by the age of 50 and 70% by the age of 70. Flexion extension treatments may help in demonstrating instability except especially compensatory subluxation. Then imaging. Imaging of the choice is MRI. Advantages, absence of radiation, non-invasive resolution, and disadvantages, cost and limited visualization of foramina. Then CT advantages can differentiate from soft disc from this hard discs, osteophytes and other things. And disc and postal longitudinal calcification can be identified in CT. Disadvantages is radiation and usually combined with myelography with contrast these side effects. Then CT myelography, advantage of alternative MRI not possible. For example, pacemaker patient with pacemaker demonstrates neural compression pathology indirectly through contour of dura. Invasive sleeve cutoff may be foraminal narrowing or lateral discs, and 70-90% usually accurate. Disadvantages are invasive and radiation. Then electrodiagnostic studies. Advantages, it helps in differentiating between peripheral neuropathies such as including such entities as carpal tunnel and confusing clinical presentations of multiple sclerosis and amyotrophic lateral sclerosis. Disadvantages is invasive and painful. Then management of the cervical disc. Peripheral neuropathies were actually mentioned. Then management. Medical management in the form of NSAIDs, analgesics and steroids. Muscle extension in acute episodes. Gabapentin for chronic neuropathic pain. Physical therapy. Cervical collar, we can mention that reverse collar now, and cervical traction occasion.
Are we still using this cervical traction? Anybody of us?
We consider that as a
diagnostic tool to an extent.
Okay, so
that you know, we give
but
the traction.
Are we offering it as a treatment?
Well, yes, I think probably you know, one can say that with caution.
Caution.
Because
yes.
Quite a few of us would believe that yes, it works. So some of us may not believe that it works.
Yes.
And it's, we always tell the patient that one sitting remains same, you may continue. One sitting, if increases pain, discontinue. Because then it gives deficit.
Based on symptoms.
That's right, based on the symptoms. So, you know, with caution would be the right word, probably, you know, wherever we feel.
Yes, sir.
Questionable doubt.
Yes. One more input. Since it is a health and treatment, so gabapentin and pregabalin.
Yeah.
Some differences there, so we can definitely include that.
Maybe we can change the name. We can put a
neuropathic medication.
Neuropathic drugs probably would be a better.
So then it will vary from individual.
Yes.
Brace immobilization neck with cervical collar is thought to diminish inflammation around a irritating root and may also diminish
same
muscle.
Same thing will be questioned about the muscle relaxant as well.
Yes.
So again, you can write down because some of us believe that, you know, muscle relaxant, it's a protective mechanism. We shouldn't be using them.
Yes.
Some of, you know, in the meetings, some people, they loudly speak about this.
Yes, absolutely, sir. Yeah.
One more, tricyclic antidepressants, not triptyline.
Yes,
that also most of the people use and
SSRIs, TCs.
You may just include it in order to include.
You can elaborate steroids into two parts. Oral steroids,
oral
as
or IV.
Methylprednisolone.
Oral versus IV.
Or are you considering IV root blocks also? The steroid root blocks also in this, or there is a different this thing? Because steroids can be given in multiple ways. It can be local injection.
Yes.
It can be oral steroids.
Yeah.
As well
and
as methylprednisolone.
Even with the steroids, you need to highlight it has to be tapering dose or whatever. Maybe. That adds to it.
Brace immobilization diminishes inflammation around the irritated nerve and may also diminish muscle spasm. Although short-term use of collars may be beneficial, prolonged immobilization more than 1 to 2 weeks should be avoided to prevent atrophy of cervical musculature. Traction, home cervical traction is of unproven benefit for cervical radiculopathy. Anecdotally, intermittent home traction may help relieve symptoms by temporarily enlarging the nerve. Physical therapy. A graduated program of physical therapy is commonly prescribed after an initial episode of short-term rest. Postural education, ergonomics, lifestyle modification may be beneficial. Massage and modalities such as heat, ice and electrical stimulation and ultrasound have not proved to be beneficial in the long term. Physical therapy has not been demonstrated to alter the natural history of cervical radiculopathy. Then cervical epidural steroid injection. The clinical use of cervical and nerve root injections based largely on theoretical and other anecdotal considerations. Well-designed placebo control studies are lacking. Complications, though rare, can be significant from cervical epidural. Then surgical indication.
Okay, just before we move that, I think it is very important for anybody to know for how long to continue with conservative treatment. That we have not highlighted.
Yes,
so the timeline for which you have to, you know, you can try and beyond which you should not, something
yeah.
like that.
Yeah. So that will come down to the natural history
yes.
of the condition. So I think we should include natural history in practically all
in
the slides,
discussion on
all the slides as well. So probably yeah. natural history if we include, then we can support that with the literature as well.
Absolutely.
And if there is no deficit, there is deficit. And then you can plan accordingly.
Plan
so
accordingly.
Natural history probably you know more than 90% they resolve from 3 to 3.
Yes.
3 weeks to 3 months. So
yes.
So one can really go ahead accordingly.
Then persistent or recurrent radicular symptoms unresponsive non-operative treatment for at least 6 weeks, disabling motor weakness of 6 weeks or duration or less, progressive neurological deficit, static neurology combined with radicular referred pain, instability or deformity of functional spinal unit in combination with radicular symptoms. These are in the surgical indications. Then preferred surgical approach for radiculopathy, usually anterior cervical discectomy and fusion, cervical disc arthroplasty, posterior lamina foramenotomy, unilateral single level soft disc disease, smokers worried increased risk for non-union, go for posterior lamina foramenotomy. Then ACDF versus post lamina foramenotomy. For Kovic et al, they found excellent to good results in 94 of the patients who underwent ACDF, excellent to good results in 75% who underwent ACDF, not statistically significant at all.
Just for knowledge sake, is there any role of still just plain anterior cervical discectomy or everyone nowadays goes only for ACDF?
Yes.
I would put a caveat there, you know, instead of wherever such thing is a caveat, you know, still not proven. Some people prefer this, some people do not prefer this.
Yeah, so if you come back with the posterior one slide back, yeah.
So you have mentioned three and we all of us know that there is a lot of, you know, debate for the first one itself.
Yeah,
so there are n number of ways to deal with the things.
So probably we need to add something there, like a caveat, something.
Anteriorly
like
making the uncomfortable window.
Yeah, n number of ways to do a anterior, removing the anterior pressure. Uh-huh. Either we do only discectomy.
Yes,
people used to do that.
Only removing that fragment by making
only window. Only discectomy. And nothing else.
I would say only one thing. You know, good decompression, supported
yes.
plus minus.
Plus minus.
Yes, that would be the right.
I think that is the best way to go.
Best way to put. Adequate
decompression. Because this is like you are putting too much of debate there.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Decompression.
So I think
plus minus.
Since it is the anterior pressure, the preferred approach would be an anterior approach.
It depends upon the type
yeah.
of disc.
So
whether
it is
central,
it is a
paracentral,
hard disc or a soft disc, some people would still prefer to go anteriorly because of the anterior pressure.
Mm-hmm.
So good decompression, number one. Number two, whether you want to stabilize it, you want to do a grafting, that is.
Depending upon
the lordosis is there or the spine is kyphotic, depending upon the disc space whether it is settled or it is maintained, depending upon the osteophytes, oncovertebral joints status.
And all these figures that you are putting here, I mean whoever has put here, do we need any copyright for these or we can use them? Because this is going to be on net.
Yeah, I think we'll have to check that as well.
Yeah, so this has to be checked whether these figures, images that what we are using, there is
or
no copyright attached.
Have our own, na? Why can't we have our own?
Yes.
That will make it less complicated.
Whoever is doing it
can
put his own.
Yeah, we can put our own.
Who is the, you know,
images
committee?
And
head
from the hostel only we can
yeah.
put them.
Within the committee, people can use their own images. That would be better actually.
Yes. Then anterior cervical discectomy and fusion is the gold standard with excellent outcomes which has been used from since
just
long.
Go back please. Yeah, that's it. So, you know, she's 16 out of 17. Now this really has got the less value because the number is too low.
Very small.
So either you take that out.
Yes, it is.
16 out of 17, you take it out. 94% good result. That's it.
Yes, sir.
So then you know if you are quoting that, it's always good that you know you quote it. But then
yes, it's
yeah.
very interesting.
I think it's better to include even the reference
yes. also.
Might as well.
Yeah, because you have not mentioned anything where it is, which year it was published,
yes,
what, how old is this paper?
Yes,
so either you put the whole thing there.
Yes,
with
sir.
The with the full reference
and as Dr. Bhardwaj said,
number of patients
is
very less.
This means that you are advocating ACDF.
Yes, sir. As it has been used since years, so that's why we are promoting.
We should be neutral.
There should be clear guidelines like where should the posterior be preferred.
Yes, sir.
As you said that in smokers the fusion chances are less.
Mm.
So that is preferred. Then again depending upon as I said kyphosis, lordosis, that also gives you guidelines whether you should go in front or whether you should go in the back.
We should not mention about any this single procedure only.
Yeah. And at the end surgeons training.
Yeah.
Whatever segmental stabilization, resorption of the osteophytes, prevention of pain, graft dislodgement, adjacent segment degeneration requiring
putting a bigger size and then give rise to axial pain.
Very
common, or I think it needs to be mentioned.
That means in the disadvantages.
Okay.
But you can put down caveat in each slide. Wherever there is a bit of doubt, you can say that, you know.
Post foraminotomy. Indicative of soft disc prolapse, patients should lack oncovertebral osteophytes, used as a salvage for failed anterior surgery. Advantage of advantage over the fusion related complications are less. Adjacent segment degeneration, post-op hemolysis 75 to 96%, excellent result, 6% recurrence rates. Discern more post-operative neck pain than SA, inability to decompress cord, does not stabilize the decreased motion segment, and hypermobility greater than 50% of facet is resected. Then cervical
just
disc.
Before this, as you said, there should be one slide of complications of anterior cervical surgery or whatever, like right from neurological, esophagus, everything at least should be highlighted.
I think that is also very important, because until a person is well versed in the complications, one should not venture into.
Complications of age procedure, yes.
Everything like esophagus, vagus nerve, everything is there.
The most important is deglutition. Yes. Painful deglutition. So that is something which is from day one even.
Then cervical disc arthroplasty, there are selected indications. Younger patients, soft disc herniation with minimal spondylolytic change without any significant instability. The advantage are motion preserving technique.
Sorry.
Yes.
What do you mean minimal spondylolytic changes? So
facet
Are you talking about any, see, this becomes too much, too vague. So for me it is facet arthroplasty, arthroplasty. So you use a specific classification to say that if it is grade 1 of facet arthritis, we can do a CDR. If it is beyond grade 1, then we should not do a CDR. So minimal spondylolytic changes is too vague. Or you can use some good hyperlinks here.
Because everything cannot be covered in one hypertrophic, like cervical. You can use hyperlinks that will mention you everything, like about cervical disc orthoplasty. Or
so this is going to be used by doctors, right?
Yes, sir.
And these doctors, we expect them to be neurosurgeons and orthopedic surgeons, right? So, so they will have all these
proper questions. Indications.
Yes,
right.
Yes. We can't just use vague terms or loose terms here.
Any article or any meta-analysis which shows cervical disc arthroplasty versus ACDM? For indications
that can come in hyperlinks, that's what I told, like after clinical presentation, signs, symptoms, everything, x-ray, MRI,
that this will thing. Be decided on that only whether patient has instability, facial arthroplasty, then we can advantage being motion preserving technique, low immobilization required, necessary, results equivalent to ACDF, multiple levels can be addressed. Disadvantage, no advantage for ACDF, especially in relation to adjacent segment, heterotrophic classification with fusion of the involved disc, implant failure displacement and long-term outcomes are not yet established. That's the end of this. So now we will go to self-assessment and
long-term. I think now we have enough data for long-term. Long-term is beyond 2 years or more than 10 years?
More than 10 years, sir. Actually, we want
okay,
those long-term
okay.
Systems. And
do we add, what is your opinion? Do we add, you know, references for each slide? Because, you know, everybody will have different opinions, right? And if we are making a PowerPoint presentation and if we are not supporting it with, so that becomes more of a dictum, like what I feel, right? So I think for every slide,
yes, sir,
we need to add references from where you are putting.
On the same slide or at the end? Like we just give the numbers.
I would prefer it to be on the same slide,
same.
But I'm open to your suggestions.
But then again, the matter becomes too much, like. Three or four lines of that reference becomes like paper presented
at the end.
At the end,
we put the same like in the textbook, like in the textbook, we put the number.
I think
bibliography
uniform everywhere.
Yeah, it should be uniform.
Yeah,
we should not be the one. But I think it is important that we should have
the reference. We should have the reference.
It is important.
Because otherwise, it becomes like a dictum. Like I'm dictating. I'm giving a pass.
And maybe.
Flowchart.
Cool.
The previous.
Have you seen the ASSI monogram? I think ASSI monogram has got quite a, you know, good few things as well.
Yes, and we can quote from there only.
Yeah, okay, and then the flowchart, maybe.
Yes.
With deficit, without deficit. With deficit, occasionally, somebody like, you know, my friend comes to me and says, my disc is gone and I have a lot of pain, but I am 50% better. And should I operate in 6 weeks' time or not?
Mm.
So the way I approach for such patients in the lumbar disc and the cervical disc
is
to go for the contrast MRI. And if the contrast MRI shows good peripheral enhancement, that disc is going to go. But that is again a debatable thing.
Mm.
But if patient has no deficit, I prefer, okay, I have got somebody celebrity who comes to me and say, yeah, you know, there's 10 opinions has been given.
Mm.
So I have a scientific way to prove that this disc is going to go up in the new
question.
It is. We are already in the study. We have about 40 cases at our center, and we ethics committee. It's going through. So it's been already, you know, in the process.
That's a very nice way of judging
whether it's so neovascularization. So that is something that can be put as well. But that will be eye opening to others. You know, suppose somebody who comes again, I'm repeating the same thing.
Yes.
I want to operate. You know, should I or should I not? Even my own disc.
One more thing in the treatment options, like people are using a platelet-rich plasma or some biologics,
yes,
or the plugs.
PRP.
If you want to have a mention of some space
PRP
for that, like.
Yes, sir.
Because I am working in Pune and near my place there is a Derwent plug.
Yeah.
You will come to know in a few times. So, and it needs regular update. No? So if the line is there, I think maybe in future.
Maybe it will.
It will.
Then we will start now the self-assessment module for cervical radiculopathy. The main objective of this self-assessment is?
Looks okay. I mean, we have
already pointed out. We have already taken care of most. No, so we can have more tea then.
Sorry, off the record.
No, but we have already incorporated most of the points. You came a little later, but we have.
Wait.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
He's from
Chabra's team, so you have to take care of him. I'm just joking. So we can, I mean, once we finish this, we can go back and.
Most of the
sit. Yes,
we have written them, we have incorporated.
Yeah, he is writing it.
The objectives are to assess the learner's insight into the subject discussed and self-assessment, a feedback for the examiner to develop better study module. The first question is, the following are the clinical syndromes of aging cervical spine except axial neck pain, cervical spondylotic radiculopathy, spondylotic myelopathy, cervical instability.
Are you supposed to answer this?
Yes.
Okay.
We have gone through this topic, so then this is of the after that.
Everything can be there.
Cervical instability we have mentioned less because most of the aging it.
what he meant to say is with the aging the spine stabilizes, the normal flexibility decreases, the mobility decreases,
the
osteophytes form, so it's a good slide.
Mm.
To highlight one study which has been published recently,
yes,
from our center, we did about 50 workers. Yeah, this is a flexion action. Have you ready? Yeah. So we did 10 bricks,
yes,
it's about 25 kg weight. We made them walk with the bricks on.
Okay.
And then we did the flexion with the bricks on. Somebody supporting. A little bit support, so they don't fall over. And we did that study. And upper cervical instability is much more commoner in those people, you know, those who have that bricks and the flexion extension.
Mm-hmm.
We are following them up 5 years now. This study was done 5 years ago. So we'll be having now those x-rays as well, whether the degeneration has taken place or not. So one of the architect girl who came with this idea, sir, everybody is lifting, so is there anything happening? So from that we have advised all the, you know, the workers to have it on the shoulder or have it on the bucket instead of putting it on the head.
On the cervical.
So one step ahead of doing a lumbar spine x-ray in supine position and doing it in a loaded position.
Which is true regarding cervical radiculopathy, pain and paresthesia are late symptoms, motor symptoms occur earlier, symptoms pertaining to particular dermatomal distortion, Hoffman's are positive.
Three.
Which is a strong associative factor for cervical degenerative disc among the following? Prior lumbar surgery is
a strong associative factor.
gender, family distribution, they are also prior lumbar surgeries.
The reference you need to mention, like
yes,
the study which showed this,
this
association of.
Okay, sir.
That shows that the degeneration is already taking place.
Taking place in the lower end.
Maybe genetic as well.
Genetic.
So that is why. Rather than.
So then familial predisposition, there also be none.
Prior cerebral trauma.
I think probably, you know, maybe.
Prior cerebral trauma and give something.
Yeah, debatable. It will be debatable. Might
this is a debatable slide.
Yeah, might as well change that. Because people will unnecessarily, you know, put in comment on that.
Okay, so the reference, we will add that.
Yeah, or else take it out.
Okay.
You can just put age or something.
Oh. Yeah, make options, different options.
Different options, yeah.
The type of herniation shown in this picture is, and the type of herniation represents which type of herniation. The following are true regarding foraminal disc, except most commonly occurs in young patients, sensory change is predominant, motor change is predominant, chronic edema, fibrous increase, sensitivity of nerve root to pain. Motor symptoms are late. Which of the following is true regarding the pathogenesis of cervical radiculopathy? Mechanical effect is block exoplasm flow. Alterations in vascular supply is additive factor adding to radiculopathy. Mechanical deformation inflation likely necessary for killings. All of the above. The following are true regarding radiculopathy occurring adults greater than 60 years of age, except most are clinically quiescent. Oncotable postulator spurs common. Most of them are osteopods or hard discs. Most of them are soft tissue herniations. The following are differential ligands of cervical radiculopathy, except herpes zoster, thorax cavus, this none. Following are provocative tests for cervical radiculopathy, except cervical compression, Valsalva maneuver, shoulder abduction test, Sperling's shoulder abductions. The picture describes which test. This type of clinical picture occurs in which disorder? Pilloried familiarity for C3-4. Should we add this or remove?
Another thing which we, that this adds on in the differential diagnosis, the apical.
This tumor, cervical rib.
Pancoast.
It's becoming now, you know. Yeah, very true. I think I missed one. From that day onwards.
Yes, sir.
You know, I always look at it. Okay. I missed one.
Shoulder pathologists are like.
This does not look pertinent to the talk.
Okay, so we remove this question.
What is your take on this?
C3-4 disc herniation affects which nerve root? C3 nerve root, C4, C both C3 and C4. No. The picture denotes testing of each myotome.
Make somebody doctor which.
No. This is like, we understand this, that this guy is testing and
yes,
the left
sir.
One is being tested. But yeah, so make it more cohesive. Make somebody a doctor, make somebody a patient.
Okay, sir.
The picture has to be more.
Denote the examiner as well as this patient. Okay.
Or you write examiner. Yeah, that has to go. अगर ये कर रहे हो then you have to use the you have to take
permission लेना पड़ेगा फिर
sorry we are giving a lot of work to do but I think when you do the motor na we need to add the sensory because like we have the in the lumbar spine the gluteal pain like here in the cervical spine there are areas where interscapular pain will be there each dermatome so that I think we need to add because that will be diagnostic, I tell you.
Yes, sir.
Patient will specifically say
upper,
upper, yeah, sensory motor. So we need to write that medial and
axial spine and related
yeah,
scapular.
That's right.
Okay, one more thing. Sorry, this picture is wrong. If you are saying it is testing C5, his hand is nowhere near C5. Normally, you are supposed to palpate the muscle contraction, right?
Yes.
So this is not depicting the right picture. C6 is extension
yes.
of the wrist. There it is being flexed. That is possibly because of the, you know, he is applying more force for the biceps.
Yes.
But biceps, uska haath fir elbow pe nahi hona chahiye. His hand should be on the biceps.
Biceps, thumb should be at least
the thumb should be on the biceps to palpate for the contraction.
On the biceps.
So this can be a tricky.
It's been 16-17 questions in total. We can remove this.
Or you change the picture because this does not go in the right way.
Pain
this is a good question.
Pain radiating to thumb commonly occurs in which type of disc herniation, affecting which level? 3, 4, 4, 5, 5, 6, or 6, 7. Ridge drop may occur in the following, except shaft of femur is fractured at the level of radial groove, C5-C6 herniation, C6-C7 and Erbus palsy. C6-C7 disc herniation produces weakness of which of the following muscle? A 45-year-old male IT professional complaining of pain over the right shoulder and arm for past month, the likely dermatome and disc level affected is? The dermatome distribution of radiculopathy, sir, we have to add that. And grip strength commonly affected in which level of disc prolapse? C7-T1. The exiting nerve root at C7-T1 level is. The following are true regarding aging spine, except earliest lesions occur at disc level, facet occipital joint, eburnation, osteophyte formation, ligamentum phloem, related.
Earlier slide, no? I think the first option you put T1 at C7 T1.
Yes.
Option one you have put C6, no? Instead of
yes,
that,
sir.
You take T1 at the top.
Okay, sir.
To confuse further.
So
okay,
so
for this particular question,
we remove this disc here, yeah, these diagrams.
True regarding disc comeback. True regarding
aging
spine. Except okay.
Ligament of phloem relatively unaffected.
Except ko highlight kar denge. Yeah. Should we highlight the except part or it, let it be like that? Because I just missed it.
Yeah.
I just missed it.
Suggestion for all the questions throughout.
Except
yeah.
Except part should be highlighted because I was reading the following are the true regarding aging. Then I was thinking, why are you labeling that as
okay? The marked area in the picture denotes the joint, foramen facet uncomfortable joint and foramen transverse edge. Aging disc has the following features except disproportionate loss of keratin sulfate compared to where we are removing this from pathophysiology, so I think we should remove this question as well.
We are making it more clinical.
Yeah, it's more of a clinical than and this biochemical level. The following are seen in the lateral radiograph of the spine except this disc height, alignment instability, functional status, joint status, all of them. 50-year-old with severe neck pain and left C6 dermatomal radiculopathy and weakness. Patient is a known diabetic and hypertensive, so he has pacemaker institute. X-rays will see C5-C6 disc reduction. All the things can be done except X-ray flexion and this. All of the following are true for CT scan and cervical radiculopathy except useful in evaluating hard discs, radiation exposure, has excellent bony and facet morphology, gives direct visualization of the dura. All are true regarding.
Yeah, but we can always
remove the
best ones and
best ones from this and remove the.
So it's good that he has provided 17. We have already knocked down 2 or 3 of them. So we still have some with us.
All are true regarding management of acute cervical radiculopathy except NSAIDs and gabapentin can try conservative for 6 weeks. Cervical collar can be applied for. Regarding the conservative management of cervical spine except short term use of collar may be beneficial, prolonged involvement more than 1 to 2 weeks should be avoided. Intermittent traction may release signals by temporarily enlarging the neuroforaminal space. Physical therapy has been demonstrated to alter natural history of the cervical radiculopathy and muscle. So this is the cervical disc. Okay. Yeah, we'll change that to cervical disc. 60-year-old patient present ataxicate, chronic neck pain, exaggerated.
So, we're not in a hurry.
After that, frequently asked questions.
Doesn't matter. You need to go to toilet, you can use toilet. There's no hurry.
You want some water? Because you are the only ones who is speaking so much.
No,
you want some water?
No, sir.
Okay.
A 60-year-old patient presenting with ataxicate, chronic neck pain, exaggerated flexes. All of the following can be followed. Except, should we add this thing in that, sir? Because we are going to myelopathy or and we are going to radiculopathy, so we can remove this one. Indication.
We have been, you know, giving a lot of work to that guy.
Yeah, so you can have a little sip of water and take the.
But only 1-2 are there now.
He's going to send it again after corrections.
Corrections ke baad. Indications for surgery in cervical radiculopathy includes all except progressive neurological deficit, static neural combined with radicular or referred pain, persistent or recurrent radicular symptoms are response to non-operative management for 6 weeks, acute motor weakness without pain. All are established advantages of ACDF surgery except single arm.
Come back to that.
Go back. Yeah.
Go back.
Yeah, yeah.
There is dangerous. This is dangerous.
I don't take it out.
Yeah,
like
this is not right.
You know, patient may not complain of pain.
Yeah.
Because that nerve fibers they have already.
It is similar to what we see in lumbar spine, painless foot drop.
Yeah.
Painless foot drop.
Yeah, painless foot drop.
Do we not operate them? We do operate them.
We should.
There is a time limit to it.
Yes.
Give the contest and explain.
Yes. So I would take this question off.
Yeah.
Or maybe change the.
This.
You have quite a few
options.
So yeah, we can knock it off.
Advantage of ACDF surgery except single or multi-levels can be addressed, destruction of the foramen, segmental stabilization, resorption of the osteophytes, avoidance of adhesions. So this the surgery shown in the picture is anterior cervical discectomy and fusion, anterior cervical corpectomy, cervical disc. The picture procedure performed is 40-year-old present with 6-6 radical failed conservative. All of the true regarding posterior foramenotomy in this patient except soft herniation is best tackled.
I think those
they can be
skipped.
See, everybody knows them, so we should put more what we can get from the topic. Is the approach classically involves V surgery, lateral mass and cervical pedicle posterior foramenotomy CDF. That was the poster for monotomy where ACDF include all of the following except avoidance of fusion related ability to decompress cord, avoidance of donor side morbidity, motion preserving surgery. Yes.
Seems okay, but with the whatever changes we have asked.
Yes.
Some questions need to be.
10 questions we will put, remove the basic questions and these
yeah.
questions where there is confusion.
Somewhere include that MIS word at least, minimally invasive
yeah.
spine,
yes,
because
yes.
again that is the future. Like a daycare procedure, posterior
laminoforamen.
Yeah,
many people do that,
yeah.
MIS.
Yeah, so now they will be advocating and that is the future definitely.
Oh. In a differential language.
Differential diagnosis.
Beginning. You are not there.
In the differential diagnosis of radiculopathy.
If you really want to touch that complication part,
yes, sir.
Might as well put the drain.
Drain.
Some people put the drain, some people do not put
do
the drain. But as in, our training has been to put the drain.
Drain, yes.
I'm sure everybody does put the drain.
Absolutely.
And we do not want to end up with the emergency.
Okay, before we proceed any further, I think we have gone through the major
yeah.
radiculopathy part
yeah,
and
sure.
we have gone through the self-assessment part. As ourselves, if I were to look at this particular presentation
yes.
to learn something,
yes.
Forgetting that we are sitting here and changing it,
yeah.
Do you think that this presentation is good enough for you to learn cervical radiculopathy or you would want something more out of it? Anybody? People
who are sitting behind.
Yeah,
do you think that this is the best answer because this is how we can make it better? Like, do you think that this is good enough for you? If you want to read about cervical radiculopathy, if you go through this presentation, you are good enough or you think that you need to still, you know, go to refer books or something like that?
To be honest, I feel the people who are not in spine, so it's a teaching thing for them. But the people who are like working in spine already.
So you mean to say that the target audience, so if it is a person who is not doing spine, if he or she reads through this, this would be good for you.
Yes.
It may not be good for a person who is doing spine, that's what you mean? Or?
So basic, this is pretty basic honestly, and if there were someone who is already doing spine, I think majority of the things which are there in this, the person will already know.
Okay.
I feel like that.
Okay, right. Anybody
sir.
Else?
No, I think few things added. Like, you know, the neovascularization, that's been going to be added. So, you know, a lot of people, they don't practice, like double crush syndrome. You know, you really want to know these things as well into day-to-day practice, which you may miss, which you may not be following in the rush or whatever, you know. So that also adds into that as well. So it basically not only basic, but also, you know, something like herpes zoster. You see,
yeah.
for 3 days, you know, so something like that, even Pancoast tumor, for that sake. So that has been added in the day-to-day practice as well. So I'm sure, you know, it holds value for practically everybody. If you read it,
I totally agree with Dr. Dave, because see, at every level, there is something. If suppose I were to look at this, I may get some few points for my practice.
Exactly.
Dr. Dave may get even fewer points than me. But for a person, let's say, Suleiman, who's doing his fellowship right now, he may get more points out of it. And as you said, so one presentation cannot cater to everybody.
Yeah.
But, you know, everybody has to get something out of it. So that way it is.
Sir, as you said, if we are really learning from it, so,
and it's not for this.
See, doing spine since last 15 years. Initially, I used to go for workshops or conferences like only non-instrumented things, like how to do discectomy, how to do fusion, ACDF. And then once you, as you proceed further, then you go for more complex workshops, complex things to learn.
Absolutely.
So for a basic startup, this is very good. Even today, I learned few points.
Yes,
new to
me,
as you said.
No. We learned that the MRI contrasting is
always
very good.
So it's a good starter.
Yes, sir.
Anything you want to add?
And most of the doctors are not already.
We also learned that the collar can be used in the reverse way.
There are more learners.
Fantastic. I never thought of it. So it was good. So even after 15, 20, 16 years of our spine surgery work, we are still learning. So I think it is good enough.
And this is not for only doctors who are doing surgery. This is for general doctors to do an OPD based treatment also for
everybody,
orthopedicians.
Okay. So this is good enough.
Yes, Ashok. In his 40-slide presentation, it's very well covered, and we can't expect to include everything. Maybe we can give some links.
Yeah, that's what we've already discussed.
We are
using hyperlinks at right places with the level 1 evidence.
Added references.
We are also trying to add references to slides or maybe at the end of the presentation.
But if you give at the end of the references, they may not be follow it properly. Maybe we should give out the each slide.
Yeah, you are right, but you know we need to have a uniform thing for every module.
Maybe it should
so
be
that we
discussed at the end of this workshop.
I missed the presentation, but I feel the presentation should be pitched at the level of a post MS or a spine fellow level,
yeah.
With references to give the advanced topics.
Point well taken.
With references to the advanced topics.
Anything else? Kuldeep, you want to say something?
Yes.
So we are good to go with this. Okay. So the changes, whatever been mentioned,
yes,
I think this is a pretty good weight presentation. Let's go ahead with the third part of this.
This is a activity-based activity. This self after the. So the first question is, how does this cervical intervertebral disc prolapse occur? So we have written the answer at the same time. Disc is an avascular structure of the first year of life. Genetic predispositions linked to disc generation in 50 to 70% of cases, lack of nutrition and oxygenation to the disc, repetitive heavy loading, heavy lifting, excessive vibrations and similar environmental factors outplay in a genetically predisposed individual, disc degeneration occurs.
This is
FAQs.
I think there is one more activity person.
FAQs are not there for
professional
models.
Professional
models. FAQs is written here, so we not have that. FAQs is
headline needs to be changed. This is actually an activity based thing only.
So it is a self-assessment, right?
Self-assessment where the previous question, sir.
Yeah, an activity-based exercise.
Why did you come here?
Oh, yeah.
You need to be
here. Vandesh, please come.
Yes.
Oh, yes.
Please come.
Hello, sir. So should we remove, sir, these or we should continue with this?
What's the take? Do we need to keep this or do we remove these? We can remove them because I think we've already covered it pretty
nicely. Covered in all the previous slides, everything is covered.
Okay.
Does this come in the main module or the consumer module?
In the main module,
in professional module, this is not
professional
required.
Module.
Professional module.
Yes, sir.
Do we have FAQs in professional
module? No.
No.
It's only self-assessment.
For these set of questions, you probably give a case scenario.
Okay.
Yeah, that would be better rather than going through all
these. Then you ask these questions in the follow-up of that case.
Okay.
See, for self-assessment morning, what Chara was telling is, the answers won't be given. Only for activity-based questions, answers will be given and explanation can be given.
Okay.
Self-assessment, there won't be any answers.
Yes.
Only questions. And the, the server will decide. Only they will send the marks.
Okay.
So
yes,
that
absolutely.
He gets qualified and he gets a certificate.
So then we can skip this and we add the case scenarios. And then, so that's it.
Okay. Anything? Anybody wants to add something to it? Not to the way? Yeah, this was it. Okay, thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you,
Dr. Suleiman.
Okay.